Let's pray and let's worship together. Father, thank you so much for giving us a new day together. Thank you that you love us so much and that we get to worship you and serve you. Please help us to bring glory to your name today as we sing praise to you, as we learn from your word. Pray for Corey, that you will prepare his heart to teach your word today, and that we will be willing to receive it. And we're so grateful for all that you've done for us. We're so excited and look forward to your return. Believe it's coming soon, and we look forward to that. And pray that you're lifted up today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing this together. Let our praise be your welcome. Let our songs be a sign. We are here for you. We are here for you. Let your bread come from heaven. Fill our hearts with your life. We are here for you. We are here for you. To you, our hearts are open. To you, our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are one desire. You alone are holy. Only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down. Let us shine. Your anthem, you're enough, fill the skies. We are here for you. We are here for you. Let your word move in power. And let your word move in power. Let what's dead. We are here for you. We are here for you. So your hearts are open. You, our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy. Say that again. You, our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy. Only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down. Let your fire fall down. Amen. Amen. Jeff, can you bring a wireless mic up here for Corey to preach with? Because we don't have one. Sorry. Apologize. Thank you, sir. coming on the clouds.
He's coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is a lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before him.
So open up the gates.
So open up the gates. Make way before the King of Kings. Our God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is a lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before him. But who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Our God is a lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before him.
Amen.
Would you free be free? Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you want evil a victory when there's wonderful power in the blood? There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. And would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Let's sing that one more time.
There is power, power, wonder-working In the blood of the Lamb, there is power, power, wonder-working power, in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Again, thank you so much. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood that you have spilled for us, that you paid the price for us through your blood to take our sins away. We're so grateful. I pray, Lord, that if there's anyone in this room today that does not know you as their Savior, they've not given their lives to you and surrendered their souls to you, that you would draw them to you by your Holy Spirit, would work in their hearts today, and that you would bring them to you, Lord, that they would surrender their lives to you, and that they could be saved by the blood of the Lamb. Pray for Corey as he comes and shares your word this morning and teaches from it. Give him wisdom, give him the words to say, and help us to be willing to receive it and to apply it to our lives today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Got halfway through that first song and realized I didn't have a mic. I was going to be doing an old tent revival if we didn't have that. All right, well, good morning. I guess I'm glad to be preaching today. I think Jason pulled one over on me because I think when he was looking at the schedule for preaching through Genesis and was looking at when he could go on vacation, he looked at chapters 33 and 4 and said, you know, child rape, killing, raping, pillaging, that's a good one to pawn off to Corey. So you got me this morning, and I'm going to have fun dealing with this. But I've titled this message, The Rocky Road to Sanctification. Not that it matters, because I didn't get any notes out to you in time, but that's kind of the idea that I wanted to go with this morning. So, sanctification, right? It's one of these churchy words that oftentimes we don't know what it means. But the word literally means just the proper state of functioning, all right? So if we take that in a biblical sense, what the Bible means when it talks about sanctification is it means to make holy, right? Or said in the reverse, to not be sanctified is to be profane, right? It's to be unuseful to God. And so the picture is this, right? We're all born sinners. Romans says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, right? So we don't have to be taught to sin, right? All of us who have children know this. We didn't have to teach them to be selfish. We didn't have to teach them to want their own way, to not obey. We all know this from our own life, right? We're sinners by acts of commission. We're sinners by acts of omission. We know what we should do. We don't do it, right? And we willfully sin, and we are enemies of God. That's our natural state, right? But then we come to a saving faith in Christ, right? And in that moment, our position, just in a snap, is changed from a child of Satan to a child of God, right? And so all of our many sins in that moment, it doesn't matter how many they are, how great they are covered in the blood of Jesus. They are gone. The guilt, the shame, the sin, it's that great exchange, C.S. Lewis calls it. I love a good deal, right? I love to find something where I can beat the system and get a really good deal. Well, this is the greatest deal I've ever gotten, right? In a moment, Christ takes on my sin, my guilt, my shame, my condemnation, takes it upon himself, pays the penalty for that, and in exchange gives me his righteousness, one that I couldn't ever achieve on my own. And it's not because I'm so great or anything that I've done, it's because Christ is so great. Right? He does that on my behalf. Now, that's only part of the story. I wish that was the end of the story, right? I wish that in that moment when we're saved, that sin was no longer an issue, that we move forward sinless, we're no longer tempted, but anyone who's been a Christian for more than about 12 minutes knows that that's not the end of the story. When we get saved, we start that process called sanctification, which means now, daily, for the rest of my life, I've got to start making the choice to every day follow Christ. In the painful circumstances and the hard circumstances, when my flesh wants to do otherwise, we got to choose daily to live for Christ. And that's really how we take up the rest of our life, right? The rest of our life is spent trying to make our position, right? Positionally, we're righteous, we're covered in the blood of Jesus, we stand holy before God, but our condition is not there yet, right? And it won't be there yet until Christ comes back or until we die and are with Christ, right? Until that time, we're struggling, we're fighting this process and we're trying to become sanctified. So we have ups and downs. We have these failures. Anyone who's been a Christian, again, you know this is not a linear process. It's not like daily you're becoming more like Christ, right? If you were to chart out the trajectory of sanctification for most believers, those of you who watch like the stock market, the graph would look a lot like the value of Bitcoin, right? So it's going up, it's great, everything's good, and it just falls off a cliff, right? We screw up, we do something we shouldn't do, we repent, we get back on the track, we go up, and then we have our next fall, right? But over time, what you want to see, right, is that it's tracking upward, that we're becoming more and more like Christ. So we have to repent, we have to get back on that road of sanctification. And so one of the things I love about the Bible kind of coming to this text is that the Bible doesn't sugarcoat stuff, right? We get to see all of these heroes of the Bible with their warts and all. Think about almost all of the major figures of the Bible have some just huge glaring sin or some common problem that over and over they're falling in. I was trying to think, who are the biblical figures that don't have any major, major sins in their life? And I'm not just talking about the daily screw-ups everyone has. I mean like murderers, adulterers, all that kind of stuff. Really, there's two. There's Jesus and Daniel. And Daniel probably only because we just don't have enough information about him. I'm sure he had his as well. The rest, again, murderers, adulterers, liars, thieves. And that actually gives me a lot of hope because that tells me that maybe despite all of my many flaws that God can potentially use me as well. And so that's kind of how we'll start into this story. Genesis in 33 and 34, if you want to go ahead and be turning there, this is the idea that jumps out at me at the life of Jacob, right? Is this constant up and down, right? The process of sanctification not being linear. Because we're going to see Jacob has these great moments where he's solid in his faith, and then all of a sudden it just drops off. And then he has to get back on the track, right? So as the story opens in Genesis 33, we see that Jacob is returning to his homeland, and he's a changed man, right? But he's not perfect yet. If you remember, Jason covered this. I think I just called Jacob Jason a minute ago, but similar names. Jacob, as Jason covered, is returning to his homeland. It's been 20 years. And so if you think about when Jacob left home, he left home a mama's boy. He was a conniving little just manipulative person, used people for his own good, didn't see people for their value. He saw them for the value they could bring to him. What can I get out of these people, right? And he finally had his sin caught up with him, right? He stole the blessing from Esau, and his brother is out to kill him now. And mama says, I've got a plan. Go stay with my brother Laban, and go away until Esau's anger kind of relents. And so Jacob does that. He goes about 500 miles away, and he's living with Uncle Laban, and it's in Uncle Laban that Jacob finally finds his match, right? So Jacob gets a taste of his own medicine. You know, the deceiver now is going to become the deceived, and oftentimes this is the method God will use to bring to light sin in our own lives, because we can often be blind to it, right? We don't think we're an angry person until we get a boss or a spouse, or someone that we can't get away from that's got that same anger, and they hold up this mirror to us, right? And they say, see how this feels? And so Jacob is experiencing that. He's been used by Laban, he's been stolen from, and this has resulted in Jacob understanding a lot about his own sin nature, and you're gonna see when he returns, he's a broken man. And he comes back, and he's willing to right the wrongs that he had with his brother Esau. So let's pick up in Genesis 33. If you remember, Jacob has been preparing for this moment. Jason covered this last week. He knows now he's got to make restitution. He's got to go home. He's made a covenant to God that he would return to his homeland. God has called him back there, and he knows that this could be a dangerous trip. He's got some things that he's got to deal with. And so Genesis 33 says, Jacob looked up, and there was Esau coming with 400 men, right? 400 men is typically not a welcoming party. I would be very, very concerned if I was Jacob in this moment about what is coming with this, right? Because he left knowing that Esau wants to kill him, and now that he's coming back, Esau's coming with 400 men with him. And so he's got to be just terrified in the state of, God, I don't know what's going to happen here. You know, it's out of my control. And so it says that he divided the children among Leah, Rachel, and his two female servants. He put the female servants and the children in front, Leah and her children next, and Rachel and Joseph in the rear. And he himself went on ahead, and he bowed down to the ground 7 times as he approached his brother. Okay? So I can tell you from experience, there's nothing like the fear of imminent death to really fire up your prayer life, right? If you saw last week, Jacob was he was praying all night. He's knowing that he's got to go back and have this meeting, and he's just laying it out there before God. God meets him. He has the experience where he fights with God all night, and now he's walking ahead of this group. He's taking the lead, and he's going to meet Esau, and he's got a visible limp, right? A limp he's going to carry with him the rest of the life as a reminder, you're not so big after all, right? You're not the one in control here. And so he might be returning a wealthy man during his time at Laban's. He did become wealthy despite all of his problems, but he's in a situation right now where that wealth is not going to help him. He is literally in a pure state of dependence on God, because just because he's wealthy doesn't mean Esau's not going to just kill him, kill all his family, take all his stuff, and that's the end of the story, right? Jacob is in a place of dependence on God. And he's made this vow. He's going to return, but he knows one thing, that if I'm going to be going back, and if I'm going to be living as the man of God, the one that God's called me to be, then I've got to make amends, right? So he understands something a lot like what Zacchaeus understood in the New Testament, right? Zacchaeus understood when Christ came to him and had his meeting with him, he forgives him, he's saved. Zacchaeus understood it's not good enough just to end right there. You know, what was Zacchaeus' response? Luke 19:8, it says, Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, "Behold, Lord, half of my goods I'll give to the poor, and if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I restore it to them fourfold." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, since he is also a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost." Zacchaeus understood it's not good enough for me to just say I'm saved, right? Just to do this in words only, right? Because your actions have to match your words. And Zacchaeus understood that my life to this point has been one of defrauding people, of stealing from them, of lining my own pockets. I can't just now come to faith and that be the end of it, and I'd just say, well, I'm going to be good from here forward, right? It doesn't work that way, right? He understood the need to make restitution. And so, in as much as we are able to, we've got to do the same as Zacchaeus, and it's what Jacob is going to do here, and we've got to seek to make restitution. Jacob could have tried to excuse himself from this, right? He's got a good reason, right? The guy wants to kill me. That's a pretty good reason, maybe, to not go have this difficult conversation. But nonetheless, he's going to do it. He seems to understand that if I'm going to be someone representing God's name, I've got to get right with those around me. So one of the points I point out is that we can't have a right vertical relationship with God and then not be right with the people around us, right? That's assumed when you come to faith, is that you're going to be right not only with God, but part of that is I'm going to be right with those around me. Okay, so we've got to get right with others. So continuing on verse 4, it says, Esau ran to meet Jacob and embraced him and threw his arms around his neck and kissed him, and they wept. Then Esau looked and saw the women and children. "Who are these?" he asked. Jacob answered, "They are the children God has graciously given your servant." Then the female servants and their children appeared and bowed down. Next, Leah and her children came and bowed down. And last of all, Joseph and Rachel, and they too bowed down. And Esau said, "What's the meaning of all these flocks and herds I met? To find favor in your eyes, my lord." But Esau said, "I already have plenty, my brother. Keep what you have for yourself." "No, please," said Jacob. "If I have found favor in your eyes, accept this gift from me. For to see your face is like seeing the face of God. Now you have received me favorably. Please accept the present that was brought to you. For God has been gracious to me, and I have all that I need." Because Jacob insisted, Esau accepted it. So it's pretty amazing here, Esau's response towards Jacob. We know elsewhere from Scripture, Esau's not a good dude, right? He's not a godly man. And yet, his response towards Jacob is pretty commendable right here. Though he's not a godly man, he's willing to overlook past wrongs. He's willing to forgive him. And We mentioned earlier the need to make restitution when we've been the ones who've done wrong. Esau actually, again, though he's an ungodly man, is a pretty good example here of being on the flip side of that. You know, oftentimes as believers, we're the ones who get wronged. And the Bible has a lot to say about how we respond to that situation. It's easy to hold grudges. It's easy to sull up and be negative towards those people. That is not the response that someone who's claiming the name of Christ can have. Just a couple of scriptures. Ephesians 4:32, be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God forgave you. Colossians 3:13, if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so must you also forgive. And then perhaps said most strongly by Christ himself, but if you don't forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. The forgiving of trespasses, I'll point out, is kind of a prerequisite to being saved. So in essence, Jesus is saying here, if you can't forgive others, knowing what I've forgiven of you, you're simply not a believer. You've got window dressing here. You don't understand the gospel. Because to know what you've done and to accept the forgiveness I'm offering, but then turn around and say, well, I'm not going to do it to this guy. He did this or that to me, right? You've completely misunderstood the gospel. To have a Christian with an unforgiving heart is a misnomer. It doesn't exist. So it seemed, though, that given this response that Esau is having, God has gone before Jacob and he has paved the way for reconciliation between him and his brother. So one of the applications here that I point out is that when God calls us to do something, even if it's hard, even if we expect severe consequences, you make it right. You do the right thing. Consequences may come, right? But take responsibility, own your mistakes, and it doesn't mean you're going to be spared consequences, right? Jacob, you're going to see through the rest of the story. He has to own the consequences of a lot of his mistakes in the story, and yet you've got to do it. That is the mark of a believer. God will honor us doing what's right. And oftentimes we miss out on the blessings and the growth that comes through owning our mistakes because we're so busy denying those mistakes in the first place, right? We're still so busy protecting our own sin and justifying it and saying why, you know, we're the exception to this rule that God's called us to do, right? And we cheat ourselves when we're doing that. So again, God has called him to make restitution. He's done it. And again, it seems that God has paved the way for this response. Again, ultimately, everything is in God's control, right? So Jacob kind of goes into this saying, God, you've called me to do this. The worst that he can do to me is kill me. So be it, right? But I point out a scripture to you. Proverbs 21, in the Lord's hand, the king's heart is a stream of water that he channels toward all who please him. God is not smaller than the situation. It's not out of his control. God is able to make of the situation what he wants. He's called us to do something. We do it, and so be it what comes. God is in control of that situation. Continuing in verse 12, it says, Esau said, let's be on our way. I'll accompany you. But Jacob said to him, my Lord knows that the children are tender and that I must care for the ewes and the cows that are nursing their young. Jacob is coming with all of these herds and his family and young children and things like that. And he's saying, if they're driven hard one day, all the animals are going to die. So let my Lord go ahead of your servant while I move along slowly at the pace of the flocks and the herds before me and the pace of the children until I come to my Lord in Seir. Then Esau said, then let me leave you some men. But why do that? Jacob asked. Let me find favor in the eyes of my Lord. So that day Esau started on his way back to Seir. Jacob, however, went back to Succoth, where he built a place for himself and he made shelters for his livestock. This is why the place is called Succoth. Now, we're not told why Jacob didn't go and meet his brother in Seir. He had just said he would. And we just simply don't have enough information in the story to know why that was. Could it be that he's up to his old tricks, right? Old sins die hard. You know, just because you were once a deceiver and now you've been through some stuff doesn't mean you can't in a moment fall right back into that same trap of sin. Maybe that was the reason, but the text in the context of the text doesn't really seem to indicate that. Perhaps he intended to go to him at a later time, right? We just don't have enough information. Perhaps he thought that, you know, we might be reconciled, but I know the character of Esau. And it may not be a good thing if we get too close, right? And that's something that all believers kind of have to deal with, right? We all have our lifestyle before we become Christians, especially if we become a Christian as an adult, and we're involved in all kinds of things that we're not proud of, right? And we can get right with those individuals, right? We can make restitution, we can ask forgiveness. It doesn't mean necessarily, though, that we need to jump back in with both feet into those same situations, right? You're a different person at this point. So whatever the case may be, we just know that Jacob didn't go to Seir like he said he would, and this is actually going to be a turning point in this story. So verse 18 says, Jacob came from Padan Aram, and he safely arrived at the city of Shechem in Canaan. And he camped within sight of the city, and for 100 pieces of silver he bought from the sons of Hamor, the father of Shechem, the plot of ground where he pitched his tent. And there he set up an altar, and he called it El Elohi Israel. So here Jacob comes to this new city, and he sets up camp. Now Shechem is a city, it's a Canaanite city, it's a really lush city, it's a beautiful city in the middle of two mountains in its valley that had this amazing farmland. It was known for its vineyards and how lush it was and beautiful. And, you know, he comes into the city. This is a city on trade routes, right? So it's booming, there's lots of business happening. And he comes and he sets up camp there, and he builds an altar. And it would seem to indicate that, you know, Jacob is setting up camp here, and he wants to honor God with his household. He sets up this altar. And there's only one problem with this situation, right? And the problem is that God had told him to go to Bethel, not to Shechem. All right? So in chapter 28, if you think back, Jacob had this this dream where he was seeing the angels ascending and descending, right? And when he woke from that dream, he was in Bethel, right? He built an altar, and he made a vow, I'm going to return to Bethel. This is a really significant place in the life of the patriarchs. And then in chapter 31, he's called to go home. And he's called, you know, God actually says to him, I am the God of Bethel, right? And he calls him to go home. So there's no doubt, Jacob knows where he's supposed to go. He's supposed to go to Bethel, but he doesn't go all the way there. He's gone 500 miles from where Uncle Laban has deceived him, and he's made this trek all the way back, and he stops 8 miles short in Shechem. Okay? Now, why? That's the million-dollar question. Why did Jacob stop in Shechem instead of going the additional 8 miles to Bethel? Again, we don't know the exact reason. Maybe the scenery was better. It most certainly is better. Again, I described for you Shechem. It was a really beautiful, lush city. Bethel, not so much, right? It's a dust bowl. It's just dust and rocks. It's desolate. It's isolated. It's away from everything. Maybe he's just thinking, you know, I could go on the weekends. You know, maybe I'll treat it like a lake home and just go up there on the weekends. It's not a beautiful place, right? But that's where he was called to go. Maybe it was because he planned to make some money. And I kind of think this is probably the scenario, because what did he do the moment he got there? He bought himself some land, right? So I think he sees some business opportunities here in Shechem. You know, maybe it was because they had that great farmland. Maybe there was a new marina being built in Shechem, and he knew property values were going up, and he could make him some money in this deal. We don't know the scenario, but we just know he didn't go where he was supposed to go. What we do know is Shechem, again, it's a Canaanite city. It was not where God had called him to. So that's where we'll pick up. Keep that in mind as we start in chapter 34. Now, Dinah, the daughter Leah had born to Jacob, went out to visit the women of the land. When Shechem, the son of Hamor, the Hivite, the ruler of that area, saw her, he took her and he raped her. His heart was drawn to Dinah, the daughter of Jacob. He loved the young woman and spoke tenderly to her. And Shechem said to his father Hamor, get me this girl as my wife. When Jacob heard that his daughter had been defiled, his sons were in the fields with his livestock, so he did nothing about it until they came home. All right, I've got problems with this area, because as the father of three girls, this is unthinkable to me. All right, so if you look at the ages and the times and everything, Dinah is probably somewhere in the range of 9 to 13 at this time, and she's just been raped. It's one of his daughters. My daughters, I have three of them, range from 9 to 13. and he does nothing. This is just unthinkable to me. I mean, I'm thinking, first of all, the fact that this young girl was raped is beyond horrific. Secondly, it's unthinkable to me that this seems to be business as usual with these people, right? This seems to be just the way things happen there, right? Women are pieces of property. They're tools. We do with them what they want. We trade them like cattle and property. It's not a big deal. You know, he just goes and says, "Dad, go get me this girl. I really like her. You know, I've tasted the goods. I want to have it all to myself now." And the dad does. He comes to Jacob, and he's going to try to make a deal for this young lady. And Jacob seems to not be that concerned. I mean, I'm thinking in this story, where the heck is Jacob, right? Why does he have this young daughter that he's allowing into the situation where he had to know this was a possibility, right? He knows the hearts of these people he's living amongst. He knows how they operate, and yet he's got a daughter that he's just kind of letting roam free, and sure enough, she gets into this horrible, horrible situation. That's what I keep asking myself, is where in the heck is Jacob? And based on what we're told here in the story, it seems that Jacob's more concerned about what reaction his sons are going to have than he is about the fact that she was raped in the first place. This doesn't compute with me whatsoever. And so rather than taking the initiative and leading his family, Jacob falls back to the original sin that especially all of us men are all prone to get into if we're not careful, and that is the sin of passivity. All right, so if you think about Adam in the garden, we like to think of this, the fall, as, man, it was all Eve's fault, right? Why'd Eve have to eat the apple or whatever it was? She got us into all this mess. But you've not read the story closely enough if you have that in your mind, because what does the Bible say? It says Eve took the fruit and ate it and then did what? And then offered it to her husband who was with her. So Adam, supposed to be the spiritual leader of his household, supposed to be protecting Eve, supposed to be leading, taking initiative, Adam is sitting back, going passive. Let's just see what happens with this. You know, maybe the serpent's right. He sits back and he goes passive. Instead of speaking truth into the situation, "Don't do this, Eve. You know, we know what we've been called to. We've got an amazing thing here, right? God has blessed us in every way." Instead, Adam sits back and does nothing. It's the original sin of most men that I know. It's a problem for all of us. It's just to go passive, just to let it happen. Okay, so rather than standing up and fighting for what's right, speaking truth to his wife in that situation, he sits back, he does nothing. And it's here that this lack of leadership, this lack of initiative and going passive, that is going to get Jacob in a lot more trouble. And it's going to take this horrible, awful situation, and it's going to get worse here because he fails to step up. All right, so I'm going to read a pretty big section here. Just roll with me here, starting in verse 6. "Shechem, the father of Hamor, went out to talk to Jacob. Meanwhile, Jacob's sons had come in from the fields as they had heard what had happened, and they were shocked and furious," you think? "Because Shechem had done an outrageous thing in Israel by sleeping with Jacob's daughter, a thing that shouldn't be done," right? They have the right response initially. They understand this should never happen, and they are furious. "But Hamor said to them, 'My son Shechem has his heart set on your daughter. Please give her to him as his wife. Intermarry with us. Give us your daughters and take our daughters for yourselves. You can settle among us. The land is open to you. Live in it, trade in it, and acquire property in it.' And then Shechem said to Dinah's father and brothers, 'Let me find favor in your eyes, and I will give you whatever you ask. Make the price for the bride and the gift I am to bring to you as great as you like, and I'll pay you whatever you ask of me. Only give me the young woman as my wife.' Now because their sister Dinah had been defiled, Jacob's sons replied deceitfully as they spoke to Shechem and his father." All right, here we're going to start to see the situation go from bad to worse, because where is Jacob? "They said to him, 'We can't do such a thing. We can't give our sister to a man who is not circumcised. This would be a disgrace to us. We will enter into an agreement with you on one condition only, that you become like us in circumcising all of your males. Then we will give you our daughters and take your daughters for ourselves. We will settle among you and become one people with you. But if you will not agree to this, then we will take our sister and go.' Their proposal seemed good to Hamor and his son Shechem, The young man, who was the most honored of all his father's family, lost no time in doing what they asked, because he was delighted with Jacob's daughter. So Hamor, the son of Shechem, went to the gate of the city and began to speak to the men of the city. "These men are friendly towards us," he said. "Let them live in our land and trade in it. The land has plenty of room for them. We can marry their daughters, they can marry ours, but the men will agree to live with us as one people on the condition that we will be circumcised, as they themselves are. Won't their livestock and their property and all their animals become ours? So let us agree to their terms and they will settle among us." All right, so these Shechemites, they're looking at this. They've come, they've proposed this deal, right? They'll pay whatever they want, and the sons, because of Jacob's lack of leadership, he's MIA in this whole scenario, they're going to take matters into their own hands, right? Now, they had a justified anger because of this scenario, right? And if Jacob had dealt with this, as he should have done, then this whole story from this point forward might be different, but it's not. Because of his passivity, because of his lack of leadership, we're going to see that this goes from bad to worse. All the men who went out from the city gate agreed with Hamor and his son Shechem, and every male in the city was circumcised. So, you know, these guys, they're adults, they decide to be circumcised. You know, circumcision is one of those things I'm glad that happens when you're a baby and can't remember anything. These are grown men, so this is not going to go well for them. It says, 3 days later, while all of them were still in pain, two of Jacob's sons, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brothers, took their swords and attacked the unsuspecting city, killing every male. All right, so as a dentist, you know, we always have to tell people what kind of pain to expect after extractions and that kind of thing. And generally, the third day is the worst. If you've ever had an extraction, you probably know that. That's when all your inflammation is at the highest, and usually it peaks at the third day, and then it's coming down. So these guys have been through something, right? This was not a fun experience for them, but they're doing it because they see a lot of cash in the deal for them. They see a lot of potential property. They're going to benefit from this, so they make this deal. And the sons had intended to be deceitful from the very beginning. They never had any intention of living up to their end of the bargain. They knew the state they were going to be in 3 days after this, and that was their intention all along, is that when they're probably self-medicating after this process, and they're all down and out, having trouble moving, that's when we're going to come in, when they're at their weakest, and we're going to kill them all. All right, so it wasn't enough for them to seek justice, right? Justice would have been dealing with Shechem. They're not out for justice anymore. They've taken their righteous anger, and now they've gone too far with it. Now they're out for vengeance. And so they don't stop with dealing with Shechem. They're going to kill the whole city. They're going to slaughter them all. They put Hamor and his son Shechem to the sword and took Dinah from Shechem's house and left. The sons of Jacob came upon the dead bodies and looted the city where their sister had been defiled. They seized their flocks, their herds, their donkeys, and everything else in their city and out in the fields. They carried off all of their wealth and all of their women and all of their children, taking as plunder everything in the houses. So do you see what I mean by going from bad to worse? This was already a terrible situation that they had to deal with. And now it's not just a scenario of the rape of a young girl that they're dealing with. Now his sons have taken matters into their own hand. They have slaughtered an entire city. And then it wasn't enough to do that. Then they've plundered them. They've taken all of their wealth. They've taken even the people from that city, the women, the children, the animals, the crops, everything. This was vengeance. This was not justice in this scenario. So I wonder, have you ever found yourself in a situation where because you're in a place that you shouldn't be in, doing something you shouldn't be doing, that it finally catches up to you and now it's all crumbling down around you? Or even worse, have you ever found yourself in a situation where you shouldn't be, doing something you shouldn't be doing, and it all begins crumbling down around you, but it's maybe not you who's going to suffer the consequences, it's your children? Consider this. Again, Jacob had the opportunity to take initiative to deal with this situation, and because he didn't, it goes from bad to worse. I've got to wonder in this scenario, would any of this have happened if Jacob was in Bethel, where he'd been called to be, where he knew he was supposed to be, where he was on his way to go, but he stops a little short? for whatever reason, it doesn't matter, would any of this have happened in Bethel? Bethel's this desolate place. There's nobody there. And maybe that was God's original intention all along with him. Maybe he wanted to do with Jacob like he did with Abraham and have him isolated in a state of dependence on God, not where he could wheel and deal and make money and do all this stuff. Maybe he wanted Jacob and his family in that scenario of dependence on God where he could deal with him and get his heart right in that time. But because Jacob stopped a little short, all of this has transpired. Jacob may have rationalized in his head that, you know, my plan is better. I mean, I know he's called me to Bethel, but again, it's 8 miles. It's not that far away. There's a lot more opportunity here in Shechem. Whatever the reason, because Jacob went to Shechem, all this has transpired, and I would love to ask the question of Jacob when we get to heaven of, if you could do it again, where would you have gone? Would you have gone to Shechem? Would you have gone to Bethel? I don't think I have to wonder about the answer, but I would love to hear from his own mouth what he would have done, because I can assure you he regrets this decision. So verse 30, finishing up, it says, Jacob said to Simeon and Levi, these are the sons who have just slaughtered everybody, you have brought trouble on me by making me obnoxious to the Canaanites and the Perizzites, the people living in this land. We are few in number, and if they join forces against me and attack me and my household, we will be destroyed. But they replied, should they have treated our sister like a prostitute? Again, they're asking the question that Jacob should have been asking, right? They're saying, our sister, a young girl, was just raped by these people, and you did nothing. You didn't stand up for her. You had her in this situation to start with, so we're going to deal with it, right? And they're clearly in the wrong as well. Don't let me excuse what they've done. That is clearly wrong. But ultimately, why are they in this scenario to start with? It's because Jacob stopped a little short, right? And that says a lot about us trying to flirt with sin, right? Sometimes we think about what God has called us to, and it seems a little too hard, right? So we want to get most of the way there, but we want to kind of hold back a little bit and hedge our bets, right? We want to keep a little bit of a foot in Shechem, maybe a little foot in Bethel. So as I look at this, I've got 3 or 4 takeaways from this. And one of those takeaways is that parents in general, and then in particular fathers, have got to fight the sin of passivity. So if we choose to be consumed in doing our own thing, rather than leading our families, rather than leading by example, following God, obeying his word, doing what we're supposed to be doing, then there's going to be consequences. And the really scary part is that oftentimes those consequences don't fall necessarily to us. They often do, but oftentimes they fall to our children, right? If you need any more reason to follow the narrow way than that, that should do it, right? Because it's the children who end up suffering the most. Consider how many kids are dead, in jail, doing all kinds of crime, living horrible lives, robbing, all this kind of stuff, because they had a father who didn't take responsibility, didn't marry their mother, ran off, did his own thing, neglected the child, leaving that mother to raise that child by himself, herself, and just went passive, just went MIA, right? That's an all too common story in this country, right? The amount of unwed mothers who are left to raise children on their own is staggering. And particularly for young boys, if they don't have that father figure around to show them by example what a man is supposed to be like, then they're left to figure it out on their own. And I got news for you. The input of the world is a lot greater than the input of the church. Likely this person isn't in church, right? So they're going to do whatever they want to do. And they're going to fall into the wrong crowd. They're going to end up in a bad place because the parents weren't there. How many children have ruined their lives with alcoholism, addiction, because mom or dad or both were also addicts? And this is what they see day after day. This is just how life is, right? It's unbelievable the number of people who are addicted to drugs and alcohol, any kind of substance, who those parents were also in that same scenario, right? They're going to pick up on what the parents do. How many kids have ruined their lives with pornography or any other sin you want to think of because mom and dad are checked out and they're doing their own thing, they're pursuing their job, they're pursuing money or fame or whatever the case may be, and they're checked out and they just simply don't know what's going on with their kids. Again, leaving the kids to kind of fend for themselves and figure it out on their own. That is not a good recipe for raising godly children. Another point, partial obedience, and similar to that, delayed obedience is disobedience. All right, we can't flirt with sin. We can't try to get as close as we can to that sin without doing it and expect that that's all going to be good. It will catch up to us. We can't live on both sides of the fence. Little God here, little worldliness here, right? There's a term for this in the Bible, and it's called lukewarm. So I'm going to give you some homework. And your homework is to go search the book of Revelation and look for how Jesus feels about lukewarm Christians. And then report back to me. He's not a fan. I'll give you a little hint. We can't be lukewarm, right? We're either in this or we're not. We can't be half-hearted in this. And if we do choose to be, and all of us will at times, right? Jacob is God's man here, right? He's the one God has chosen to do this. And Jacob is trying to live in both worlds, and he's going to pay the consequences of that. Third point, God is incredibly gracious in forgiving us, but don't fool yourself into thinking that because God is gracious and because God forgives us, that you're not going to suffer consequences. We are absolutely going to see the consequences of our sin. Those will always come home to us, right? And you know, there's a saying about wisdom, that wisdom comes from experience, and experience comes from a lack of wisdom, right? The point being that, you know, oftentimes you become wise because you've been there, done that, you've screwed up, you've made these mistakes, and because of that, now you've learned and you've gained the wisdom to know not to do that again, right? So that's one way of acquiring wisdom, right? It's through experience, through your own screw-ups. The biblical form of wisdom, the one that I would recommend, is that I don't have to be the one that screws it up, right? I can look to God's word. I can look at what God has called me to do, how I'm to live, and I can simply do that and not have to go through all the pain and the suffering that comes from me screwing the whole situation up and then dealing with the consequences of that. I would highly recommend that method of wisdom as opposed to wisdom from experience. We're all going to experience both of those, but the more that we can model our lives as God has called us to do as opposed to learning it from our own screw-ups, the better our life is going to be. Fourth point I'd say, think about when this happened to Jacob. When did this go downhill in the story? Was it when he was really struggling and, you know, close to God? This story happens, and it all goes downhill coming right off of Jacob's great spiritual high, right? When he was closest with God, when he was in the state of dependence, when he's had this dream and God has spoken to him, he's seen these great visions, he's come back, he's owning up to things, he's making restitution with his brother, he's going back to the promised land that he was supposed to be in, and it's then that Satan tempts him and that he has this great fall. Because oftentimes, this is the scenario, right? We come off these great spiritual highs where we've been in a state of dependence on God, and God has really shown up for us, right? He's come through, and he's saved us from a given situation. And that's when it's really easy, if we're not careful, to get cocky. That's the time when we got to worry about falling, right? Pride comes before a fall. It's easy to get prideful right after you've had this great spiritual high, okay? If Jacob could have kept that dependence on God, that understanding that, man, I am in trouble if God is not leading me, if I'm not walking in the path God has me on, that's when I have to worry about falling. And because he didn't do that, because he comes off the spiritual high and things are great, right? It's easy to start compromising with the world at that point, right? And Jacob begins compromising. He stops short of Bethel, and he spends these years in Shechem, and they become a huge problem for him, right? So be careful. When things are going well, that's the time to look out for when Satan's going to tempt you. And then the last point, I just think about, you know, based on what I read, it looks like Jacob was in Shechem for about 8 years before this happened. So that's about 8 years of things going great, right? Wealth is accumulating. Everyone's doing good, right? We're in this beautiful place. Things are going well. And then all of a sudden, it falls off a cliff. And I have to wonder, how much did Jacob miss out on because of 8 wasted years in Shechem? How much suffering did he have to go through? How much suffering does his family have to go through because of this time in Shechem? See, we often have this idea that the commands of God are a hindrance to us living a full life, right? Every one of us falls prey to this, right? That we've got this or that we want to do, and it's contrary to what God has called us to. And so we treat God's word as if it's this limiting factor on our life, that it's keeping us from being able to live life to the fullest, to experience all that we want to experience. And we neglect to realize that God is the one who set this whole thing up, right? The Bible says that Christ came to give us life and to give us that more abundantly. So God set this whole world up. He has his intentions of how this world is to operate and how we are to live and thrive in this world. So when we look at God's word as this hindrance to us living a full life, we do so at our own peril. When we choose to rebel and go our own way, we bring upon ourselves the suffering and the problems, but not just that, we miss out on all that God had intended for us in that time, the fellowship, the growth in our faith, the struggles that we would grow from. We cheat ourselves by hanging out in Shechem when we could have been living abundantly in Bethel. So I'm going to end with this. Marty, if you want to go ahead and be coming up. This C.S. Lewis said it better than I'll be able to say. He says this in his sermon, The Weight of Glory. And this hits home with me, that we're all too prone to settling for what the world has to offer until it all comes down around us. So C.S. Lewis says this, "It would seem that our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. We are half-hearted creatures, fooling around with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered to us. Like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are far too easily pleased." So with that, I would just say, if you are in a scenario, as I've certainly been, that you've spent too much time in Shechem, right? Doing your own thing, living your own way, contrary to the will of God, it's never too late to turn around. I'll give you a little preview. Next week, Jason's going to cover chapter 35. After this situation, God is going to come to him, and he's at his lowest, and he's going to remind Jacob, go to Bethel. Do you think Jacob wasted any time heading to Bethel after this scenario? I bet he just blew the dust off these people getting out of Shechem. He is going to go to Bethel, and it's not until then that Jacob is going to see the patriarchal blessing. That is when he's going to experience the blessing of God. That's when God is going to make him into a great nation, not in Shechem.
And together.
Are you hurting and broken within, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to me.
sing, oh, what a Savior.
And oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? A king, hallelujah. Christ is risen. And bow down before him. For he is Lord.
Come to the altar.